Okay, it's 10 minutes past 10. I think we start.
Welcome to Michael Hudeman. He's a guru in the CI community, has written several books, including DevOps for Developers and Agile ALM.
Wow.
So thank you for coming, Michael.
Thank you very much. You are well prepared. Thanks. It's a big pleasure to be here and to talk to you. And wow, it's impressive. We have around about, I think, 400 attendees in this session. And so I hope that you had a great start to your DevOps day today, and that you don't fall asleep now because it's pretty dark. So again, welcome to the session, Adult Continuous Delivery and DevOps. So why adult? This has a couple of reasons. One major reason is because those demos and tool chains are largely based on real-world success stories, right? So it's not just a textbook example. It's more, right? It's really heavily aligned on real-world practical use cases. So the roadmap for today is that first of all, I would like to start to set the stage and shape the big picture, right? Then I like to zoom in to some single parts of the overall tool chain. So I prepared something for today. Actually, I pretty often give a similar talk and an interactive session. It's pretty interactive, right, and demo-driven. And I try to align the content a bit with the audience and the conference, of course. So I hope that you like it. So after zooming into some single parts, I would like to have an open discussion and would like to answer any questions latest then, right? Some disclaimers first. So although those are real-world success stories, it of course, as you know, it depends on the use cases, on your specific requirements and basic conditions, right? So this works in many cases, but maybe based on your specific use cases and requirements, you may find an even better solution. What was already said, there are a lot of different books and a wide community, right? So you may want to read more in a lot of different books, not only my books. So this demo-driven session is more about tools, tool chains. So of course, it's also even more important to use or to apply good practices, right, and agile approaches. So if you want to learn more about practices and of course also the tools, please consult the documentations and all that stuff, right, and books, and go to extremes and talk to your colleagues in your company, right? So it's actually only 45 minutes now, and you know, there are a lot of different tools which are connected. So that's also real world, right? We already have a couple of different tools in place and want to glue them and want to connect them, integrate them, and form and build a holistic delivery pipeline. So it could also feel obviously one complete week, right? So it's just zooming in, giving you some teasers and appetizers that you have something to do over the weekend. The last, actually, yeah, that's a teaser, right? The appetizer. So my name is Michael, what was already said. So let's start with shaping the big picture, right? So there are many different ways to come up with a delivery pipeline, a DevOps tool chain. So you may also try to find the agile approach, to just open the Jenkins build engine and fiddle around and set up some delivery pipelines, right? So maybe this works as well in many cases. but they are also more heavyweight or process-driven approaches, starting with setting up a value stream map, right, just to identify and visualize the different stages, the stakeholders. That's also a big benefit already, right? To identify the activities, the lead times, and also some waste times and all that stuff. So having that in place, you can derive some sort of DevOps target architecture, forming some stages, quality gates. So those are doors, right? So doors to open and to go through, right? Between some stages, you have an environment for Jenkins, for example, which packages the artifacts application across different artifact types, including Java, Groovy, and many more. And you just want to stage and configure this application towards production, right? And don't want to repackage, rebuild the complete application several times. So that's also part of what I've told you, some practices. But we want to focus on tools today, right? So having those staging ladder, the staging pipeline, we can now actually implement the pipeline itself. So for example, it's a no-brainer to nowadays use Jenkins 2, for example, but also others would work, such as SteamCity or Bamboo, to actually just implement the pipeline, right? And with Jenkins 2, it's really easy to configure, to describe with the Jenkins 2 native delivery pipeline features, with DSL, and it's actually Groovy-based, to just form the pipeline. Okay, let's now zoom in further to the concrete setup we want to discuss here today. So in our example, we have a couple of different sub-pipelines, right? That's also important to understand that overall holistic pipeline can also have some manual triggers in between. So we have some sub-pipelines which are glued by manual steps. So if a continuous build, we have a pipeline for continuously producing versions, right? So that's the major part of the session today as well. And we have a dedicated build pipeline to cherry pick, actually, release candidates, RC builds, right? So it's up to a lead developer or the agile team or dedicated config management department, or maybe the best case is to have a business, a domain expert, to just cherry pick a dedicated version to be a candidate for going live. And finally, we have also a GA, a general availability build, which is again cherry picked and promoted actually finally to the target environments, to the production environments, and also made available for usage. So having that said, we can now zoom in and drill down further to those different pipelines. So the first pipeline is pretty easy, right? So you have some few stages, just checking out code from GitHub in this example, compiling it, running some unit tests, and that's all, right? So it runs a couple of seconds, more or less, and just gives fast feedback for the developers, particularly. The second sub-pipeline is what you know already now is the pipeline for the dev versions, right? The ongoing versions. So what you see here is we have a lot of boxes and colors. So hopefully you like it. So we again start with setting up a reproducible environment, doing some housekeeping, right? That's very important. Checking out the code, compiling, unit testing, and also setting up build environments. So for example, spawning some Jenkins agents, or just setting up some containers and all that stuff, right? The next steps include to run the integration test. So we already have the maybe final package of the software, including different artifacts. Right, so in this example, the application consists of Java, so it's a Java web application, and it's embedded and packaged to a Docker image, right? So that's actually our use case, and we want to test it, apply some integration tests, and afterwards we want to certify the WAR file, right? So that's also very important, from my perspective at least, that it's not only about binaries and artifacts, but it's important to have context information on those binaries, right? So it's very important to label, to certify the artifacts if tests already run, or the status of the binary, to attach, to annotate the binary with some meta information. It's very important. Then we have some migration steps, and all those different steps are really running on my system and in the cloud, connecting all those different nodes. Then we also have some source code inspection. We want to detect any codes, flaws, and design smells as Donor Cube. It's also very handy to include this to the overall tool chain and set up some quality gates with SonarQube. But that's not the topic for today. Then afterwards, we may find it helpful to distribute the WAR file, right? So the WAR file is deployed, is pushed to our binary repository manager named Artifactory. Afterwards, we want to inspect the WAR file. So we did perform already some inspections on the source codes with SonarQube, right, to detect some design flaws and architectural anti-patterns. And now we have the binary and want to inspect the binary with X-ray, right, to detect any vulnerabilities or license issues. So that's also very important. Afterwards, also during build time, right? So if we have detected any flaws, we can just stop the line and stop the progress and break the build. Afterwards, we want to package and build the Docker image, right? So that's the next step, and do any smoke tests and sanity checks on the container if the web application already runs, if it deployed successfully. That's very important, right? And the next steps include to distribute the image. What does it mean? So again, here we have Artifactory. That's our universal binary repository manager, which can also serve as a Docker registry, right? So we have one single stop to serve them all, and which holds all artifacts, dependencies, incoming, outgoing dependencies, including the WAR file and also the Docker image, right? So all those different aspects which make up our release, which is consistent functionally and technically. We can, again, annotate the Docker image, label it, certify it, and afterwards we also want to inspect the Docker image. Right, so it's crucial to also detect any flaws in this image. So our image is based on Ubuntu, has a couple of layers, adding Tomcat, web container, adding the WAR file, and all that should also be quality assured, right? So that's very important. Then the next step is, you know, what you see is we just drill down a bit. We have the release candidate toolchain. And finally, the tool chain of one stage, actually, to press a button to promote an RC to be a GA, right? So distribution is done to Bintray. So all artifacts are managed and held in Artifactory, and the final GA builds are promoted and made available with JFrog Bintray. So there are more boxes and more colors to come. So if you want to take a picture, maybe pretty soon, but not now. So what I said already is that we have a very heterogeneous zoo of different tools, right? So it's often a tool zoo of different tools which are in place for many years, partly, right? And you have to connect them and to glue them together. And so our use case and our running system connects and integrates all those tools. So that's a running demo here on my system and connecting some SaaS and cloud solutions and on Amazon partly. And so that's the use case. And yeah, we can talk about it for 1 week, day and night. So it's essential to drill down a bit and to talk about different specific areas. So I would like to quickly discuss the built environment provisioning. So that's the first case, how this can be done with Chef. Then I would like to a bit more focus on inspecting the wall and the Docker image, this X-ray. And the, oh yes, I have some numbers. Then I would like to continue to discuss the distribution to Bintray and also include that to some functional monitoring, right? To show you some options how to get data from Bintray statistics, right? Who has downloaded the version, for example, and to integrate that to the ELK stack, also to show you how to integrate those tools to other tools in the overall toolchain. So those colored tools are covered in this session. So that's the roadmap. Okay, does it make sense? Yes. Okay, so first of all, I can open, so it's really interactive, right? So I change a bit this night and we'll see what happens. So let's start and open the Jenkins dashboard, right? So what you see is what I explained already. We have the direct mapping, the implementation of the visual graphic, right? So we have a continuous build on the top and we have a pipeline for delivery dev versions. And also the builds for triggering RC and GA builds, and some convenience builds and other stuff. So the pipeline which has most attention now is this one, right? So we use what you see already is we use the Jenkins 2 pipeline features. We directly see the different stages. They map to what I've presented already. We have those quality gates, SonarQube, X-ray, and all that stuff, right? So that's a pretty long processing step, but actually including building Docker images, packaging, inspection, the build just runs a few minutes, 3 or 4 minutes, so it's really quick. So maybe it's also interesting for you to see that Jenkins 2 has a really nice new dashboard, right, to show the pipelines. That's this one. So it's really neat and handy. And actually, last week, the CloudBees guys from Jenkins promised me to even optimize this repainting. That's a really huge pipeline does fit on one display, right? Because it's so long. Okay, now we can quickly start the build. So now it's processing and checking out the code, packaging, inspection, Docker image creation, and all those different steps. And in the meanwhile, because it takes 3 to 4 minutes, I can quickly show you how Etifactory can manage your Chef cookbooks. Right? So if you use Chef or Puppet, you can easily use Artifactory to host and manage your cookbooks. So actually, Artifactory is serving as a private supermarket. So what you see here is, for example, a Python dependency, which is used, included in the build chain, and is downloaded from the Chef supermarket and put into this proxy in Artifactory, right? But we can also upload and share our own homemade cookbooks to Artifactory. On the other side, there are many different options to run, to execute, and to integrate those Chef processes. This is one quick example how to do it. So after some ramp-up activities and configurations, we can easily use Knife with Artifactory and just download and share artifacts and libraries. So that's all. It's really easy. Okay, now let's just turn back to the Jenkins. What is going on here? We see the log file. Those are actually the findings of X-Ray. So a lot of findings, right? So many license issues, depending on the configuration, right? So it depends on how you configure the tools. So this is the build time scanning of the WAR file. This is implemented like this. Can you see this? Yes. So that's all, right? So once you have installed the X-Ray application and did some initial configuration steps, that's all. So we just configure the build stage based on actually Jenkins 2 and also Groovy actually, and yeah, trigger the scan. And we configure that the build should not break if something is found, because we have 140 findings. It would be too tough to fix them all now and to proceed. So that's this one. Okay, okay, okay. So here we see that the Docker image is actually built, and the recently packaged WAR file is packaged to the Docker image. That also means that we already have inspection in X-Ray, right? The inspection of the WAR file. So we can double check it and go to X-Ray. Tara, that's X-Ray. And see that build number 379, does it match to our build? Yeah, you know, it's indeed this build. Was inspected, and obviously 106 issues were detected. Ooh, we can navigate into the alerts and get further information. So we have a lot of different vulnerabilities, permissions, Transformer Factory in Apache version. Right, so that's the finding here. We have an impact path, so showing that the WAR file includes this library, which has some vulnerabilities. So maybe one reason we have so many findings is that I configured X-Ray to have Apache license 2 as on a blacklist. So every dependency which has this license is a finding, right? Just to demonstrate. Okay. X-ray. Let's go back to the pipeline console. Okay. So that's the integration test, the identity check. Hello world, it's okay. The Docker image is built. And then hopefully pushed to our Artifactory Docker registry. This is actually this logical repository. So what you see is that we have a Docker registry that is named Docker Dev Local, right? And we, for example, also have configured Artifactory and X-ray that no downloads are possible if any findings exist. So that's also very interesting. And yeah, so here's our Docker image in different versions. And that's it. So the pipeline was completely processed. Okay. So next on, maybe you remember that as a downstream step, we have the inspection of the complete Docker image, right? What we saw was that we inspected our WAR file. But now we also want to have information about the Docker image, including the WAR file. So I do a refresh, and now I see indeed some new alerts, which show 190 issues, right? So those are the issues from the WAR file, 106 plus 3 regarding the middleware and the Docker image. So we can also again zoom into the Docker image and just browse and work on those findings. So it's really neat and sophisticated to have a transitive impact path, right? So you can work and see all different layers, including the Docker image, the WAR file in our example, right? And all libraries inside the WAR file. Okay, so that was the inspection with X-ray, and now we can continue to actually creating a GA build, right, to bintray. So bintray is this application, it's also from JFrog, and it hosts a lot of different third-party products, libraries, open-source projects, Groovy, for example. And what you also see here is that I like cats. So, cats. So this is the place where I promote and publish my final release, right? So we have a project, repositories. It's actually too much to cover all those different aspects. But the final application is just version 1.0.0, and it is hosted in this repository. Meow. Right. So this is bintray. And so what we want to do now is that we we use the so-called Firehose API from bintray, so it just provides data, usage data, download data, for example. So we open a stream using the JFrog command interface, connecting to Bintray and connecting to the stream of Bintray and redirecting the stream to a local file on our system. So that's all. So we have a file now locally with all those information what's happening on Bintray. Now, the next step is that we would like to create the ELK stack based on Docker. Something happens. Good news. So in the meanwhile, I can show you, for example, that it is pretty easy to configure Logstash as part of the ELK stack. To just actually process this local file, right? So that's the input file. That's the output of our redirected Bintray stream. And we output it to Elasticsearch. Chaka. Okay. So it looks like we now have the ELK stack up and running. And we now need to initially just stream in some data. And what we do now is to just trigger a GA build. So this just promotes the artifacts from the RC stage to the GA stage. That's all. So this means that we now have the new version in Bintray. Let's double check. Six minutes ago. Okay, so that's the version. And we can now again go to Kibana and proceed with some configuration. So let's do this, and let's discover the events. And we also already see that two operations were processed on BinTray, right? So we have one delete operation. So that's part of my example demo that I first of all delete the, don't do that in production, but to delete the version from BinTray just to again upload the new version of the same release for demo purposes. So it's the type of deletion and an upload, right? So that actually, does it fit to our expectations? I think yes. So we have two different operations. We can now quickly raise up a pie chart, for example. Let's do this and let's do that. Quickly doing some stuff and adding filters for uploading, because we already had an upload, right? We add a filter for download, coming next, and we have a filter for delete. And we can then show what happens. On indeed, we have this ratio, right? Now, finally, we can just download the final release, so manually, also scripted, of course, and I just trigger a scripted solution, which just downloads the file, and afterwards we maybe see some, ah, cool, it worked, wow. So now we have one upload, one download, and one delete. Regarding downloads, because it's a distribution platform, right? You can distribute Docker image, WAR files, all different artifact types is BinTray, and you want to monitor, functionally monitor those operations, the downloads particularly with BinTray. So that's the reason, because BinTray also has some statistics out of the box. So we can open the statistics page and see that we have, one download. So that's the download we've triggered recently, right? So it's visualized here. And pretty neat is that we can also see that our download occurred from so, Denmark is white, it's not colored because, no, it must be colored. The download location is always colored. Why is it white? Who knows it? The one who knows it gets a gift. The reason is because I'm connected to some target systems via VPN, so those are based here. So that's the reason the download is visualized as being triggered from Israel. So that was the part of BinTray, GA, ELK stack. And now finally, quickly, we can have a brief look at least on how to extend Artifactory. So those tool chains are heavily based on Groovy, so Artifactory can be extended with plugins which are written in Groovy. So one example is that I can show you. Is this one. Oops. So I told you that it's meanwhile, very important to annotate binaries with meta information, right? So in our use case, we label artifacts the QA label. And we also download artifact, and we try to download it actually. And if it is not labeled as QA, the plugin just prevents the download, right? And cancels it. That's what you see here, right? So the plugin just implements this sequence of statements. That's all to just write and roll out this this plugin actually. So I think we are done with the quick round trip, and maybe it's now, before we start with the discussion or questions or having a coffee together, it's a good opportunity to clap your hands. Thank you. So any questions or comments? X-ray is indeed the example which is not free. That's exactly the example which is not free. Even not for open source, I think, yeah. That's a good question. Yeah. So also this one depends on your use cases and basic conditions. So in this example, I have a couple of different images, a base image, which is actually based on Ubuntu, right? But there are other systems, operating systems, which have a not so huge footprint, right? So that's the first case. Also, it depends on what you want to add to the images, right? So, so it really depends on the use cases. Yes. It is actually the size of the raw image, yes, but I have to rebuild the image because the raw changes. So I want to, in this use case at least, I want to distribute the new image, including the raw file. So maybe there are also other solutions. That's a good point. Docker uses some caching. That's important to understand. So some more questions or comments? No? They relate. So the architecture from At the factory is that it's enabled for a lot of deploys, whereas Bindra is more for deploying once and reading and downloading very often. That those are different use cases. On the other side, last week, JFrog had its user conference and was announced to work on a platform which just deeply connects those tools. So also Bindra will be available on premise, not only in the cloud, forming a complete platform, also including mission control, we didn't mention it, and X-Ray. So those interfaces will merge somehow in this platform. You have to, if you want to use X-Ray, you must have an Artifactory installation. So X-Ray just inspects binaries which are somehow connected to Artifactory. Okay, so thank you very much for your time.